Harvard-held co-host of Metabolic Health Summit, and we have got a very special guest today live. I'm so glad you're joining us. We had a little bit of issues over on Facebook, but we're going to be going live now on Instagram. And like I mentioned, we're covering a very important topic today, the topic of mental health. And there's a good chance that either yourself or a loved one or friend might suffer from some sort of mental health issue. In fact, over 322 million people are clinically depressed, and it's clearly a growing problem, one that is actually the leading cause of disability in the world. And there is a pioneer in this space who is really looking at the integration of mental health and metabolic disorders. He has over 15 years of experience in using the ketogenic diet. His name is Dr. Chris Palmer, and he is in the room, and I'm going to be inviting him in here in just 1 second. And we are going to have a conversation about mental health, and he's going to be speaking at Metabolic Health Summit this upcoming January. You can go to metabolichealthsummit.com to learn more information, to see our whole lineup of speakers. And we're really going to be covering topics all the way from cancer to human performance and optimization to things like mental health that truly affect so many people around the world. He's a researcher, he's a psychiatrist, and he's going to be coming to January. To our conference in January, and I'm excited to bring him in here. Let me add Dr. Palmer in, and if you have questions, please definitely let us know, because we would love to answer them. So let me see if we can add him in here. All right, so as we're waiting for Dr. Palmer to accept the invitation, I want to mention again that early bird tickets are on sale for Metabolic Health Summit. But not for long. We do sell out, so make sure you guys head on over to go get your tickets. And there he is.
Hey.
How are you?
I'm well. How are you? Thank you so much, Victoria, for hosting this and for all of your work on the Metabolic Conference. I'm really excited to be part of it this year. So
we're thrilled to have you. Truly, you're doing such important work that affects so many people. And you're really, in my opinion, one of the pioneers in the space, specifically in that field of mental health, who's really looking at all of the different factors that come into play when we're dealing with mental illness. And you're actually involved in some research involving schizophrenic patients as well as opioid addiction. And I just find it so refreshing that you're incorporating nutrition into your practice. And you've been doing it for 15 years. It's not something that's new to you. So we are so honored to have you at Metabolic Health Summit this upcoming January. So thank you for joining us.
Yeah, no, thank you. And I'm honored to be part of it. So this is, you know, this is a really exciting, field. And I think really kind of extremely exciting developments. And as you mentioned, the mental health world, there's a crisis around the world right now. And you mentioned the rates of depression. It's the leading cause of disability right now. But mental disorders across the board are on the rise.
Yeah.
And in the, you know, we've noticed this trend for at least probably 30 or 40 years. And researchers have largely ignored the trend because people were trying to come up with explanations, because our current theory is that mental disorders are mostly genetic. They run in families. So it must be bad genes. There must be genes for schizophrenia. There must be genes for autism. It's got to be genetic stuff. And so people kind of were trying to figure out, how is it that genetic disorders can increase in frequency over such a short period of time? Because that doesn't make sense. Right. That can't possibly be happening. And so they were making all sorts of excuses for, like, why are the rates seeming to go up? And the excuses ranged anywhere from, you know, well, we're recognizing mental disorders more commonly, and people are getting treatment, people are getting diagnosed, and it's not that the disorders themselves are changing, it's not that the rates are increasing, it's that we're getting people, maybe with mild disorders, more effective help. And isn't that a wonderful thing? Everybody's getting effective treatment. And that sounds good, and it made sense. But over the last 15 to 20 years, we now have definitive evidence, and the evidence is alarming. And it is that the rates of almost every single psychiatric diagnosis that we have are increasing in the population, in the United States in particular, but across the world. Yeah. So anxiety disorders, over the last 15 years, we are dispensing 3 times more anti-anxiety medication to our population than we were just 15 years ago.
Wow.
For depression, you said it, it's the leading cause of disability. Depression rates are up. When we look at rates of things like bipolar disorder, those rates are alarming. So among adults, over the last 15 years, the rates have doubled.
Wow.
Among children and adolescents, the rates have gone up 40-fold.
Oh my gosh.
That means a 4,000% increase in the rate of bipolar disorder. Autism rates have tripled in 15 years, 300% increase. And I want to point out that I professionally think it's not a coincidence that the rates of all of these mental disorders are skyrocketing at the exact same time that the rates of metabolic disorders are skyrocketing around the world. The rates of obesity, the rates of diabetes, the rates of cardiovascular disease are all skyrocketing. Right. And I think it is not a coincidence that mental disorders are increasing at the same time. And when we look at treatments for mental disorders, you know, I'm the first to say, so I'm a Harvard psychiatrist. I run a continuing education department. I train people in the kind of traditional conservative ways to treat mental disorders. And for some people, our treatments do work. Yeah. And I don't want to ever be accused of trying to deprive people of effective treatment. I'm not here to be anti-medication. I'm not here to be anti-psychotherapy. I'm here to help people who are suffering and whose lives are ruined. And if medication can help you or your loved one, I'm all for it. If psychotherapy can help you or your loved one, I'm all for it. But the reality, given these staggering statistics, the kind of more concerning reality is that when we look at our treatment outcomes, our treatments are not working. They're not working for the majority of people. So the majority of people, more than 50% of people who have even bread and butter psychiatric diagnoses like anxiety disorders or depression,
right,
they end up having a chronic disorder. Their disorder does not, so treatment can work for them for a few years and they can get better for years, but then the medication for some unexplained reason stops working. Or they get stressed in their life and then they get depressed again or they get really anxious again. And when we look at statistics across the board in huge population studies, the conclusions are clear. And the conclusions are that mental disorders across the board are chronic disorders. We know that things like schizophrenia and bipolar disorder are chronic disorders. Usually we say they're lifelong disorders. People are often disabled by those. They often can't work. A lot of them can't live independently. Many of them never end up getting married. They don't end up having families of their own. I mean, that's like a life that is unfulfilled. That is a life of suffering, a life of misery sometimes. And I'm not saying those things to be mean or to... I'm like the ally and the advocate for these people. I want to help them. But we have to do a reality check and we have to own the fact that our treatments are failing a lot of these people. And that kind of brings me to why I'm part of this and what I've been doing over the last 15 years. So, you know, I came to low-carb, ketogenic diet for my own personal reasons, like 20 years ago.
I was going to ask you, was it, you know, usually, it's funny, a lot of our speakers who are physicians, you know, or in psychiatry or whatnot, typically they will start themselves on a ketogenic diet, maybe not talk about it at first, go through the process and notice these just profound changes, whether it be mental clarity, whether it be, I just talked to a speaker last week who was sharing how she was pre-diabetic and decided to go on the diet. Now she's, you know, using it in her practice. So was it something similar to you? What sparked that next step of, okay, I'm going to try high fat, moderate protein, low carb diet, which, you know, I'm sure at the time, 15 years ago, wasn't really a thing unless you maybe had epilepsy. So how did that start for you?
Yeah, so for me, it actually started with kind of the traditional Atkins diet,
okay,
which was ketogenic for me, at least initially. And it started because, you know, I had just been through medical school. I was doing my internship and residency. I was pretty disciplined. I exercised pretty regularly, and I was doing what was supposed to be a healthy diet. I was on a really low-fat diet.
Yeah.
So I ate, you know, lots of whole grains and fruits and vegetables.
Doing the right thing.
I had a turkey sandwich with mustard on it. No mayonnaise, but that's got fat in it.
I don't know what you were thinking.
Yeah, God forbid. I never ate eggs. No red.
Oh, I could eat every day. Eggs, I could literally eat for every meal. I don't know how you did that, but continue.
Well, this is what I eat every day now too, but at the time, that's not what I ate because I was trying to be a good person. I was trying to take care of my health. This is what I had learned in medical school. This was what was supposed to, you know, help me be healthy. And unfortunately, it wasn't working. I was maybe a little bit overweight, but not really. I was kind of like one of those skinny people who had a little bit of a gut, and but I worked out enough, and so I wasn't by any metric really even overweight. I certainly wasn't obese, and yet my blood pressure was going up, my bad cholesterol was skyrocketing, my good cholesterol was really low, my triglycerides were really high, and those are all basically bad things. So. Yeah. All of the cardiovascular disease risk factors that I was desperately trying to avoid were getting worse on this plan. And I would go year after year to the doctor asking him, what am I supposed to do? Like, and he would always say diet and exercise. And I'm like, what diet? And low fat diet. What kind of exercise?
I'm doing that.
I'm like, I'm doing it. I'm doing your prescription. And, and I finally, it finally got to the point where the doctor told me, you've got to go on medicine. Like, your blood pressure's too bad. Yeah, everything's getting worse. You're pre-diabetic. Like, this is bad. And I was really frustrated and disheartened with that because I kind of felt like, no, if I work hard, I should be able to do this. And it wasn't working out for me. And so, I had talked to people who had done the Atkins diet and had actually had reversal of diabetes, had actually had improved their cholesterol by eating eggs every day and all that stuff. And so it kind of been an act of defiance. I was just pissed off. I was pretty sure I was going to have to go on medicine. I was pretty sure I was going to end up diabetic, having a heart attack when I was 50, no matter what.
Gosh.
Because it was all supposed to be genetic, and I was just screwed, and that was all there was to it. And so in an act of defiance, I went ahead and tried the diet. Lo and behold, like 3 months later, everything got better.
Wow.
But you're right. One of the things that I noticed personally was that I started having more energy than I had ever really had. Like, there were always these happy, peppy people out in the world who seemed like they had it all together, and they were smart, they were successful, they were athletic, they were good looking. That was never me. That was them. I was one of the other people who never had any of that going for me. And I really felt like, you know, I have to work hard to keep up with medical school. I have to work hard to keep up with my internship and residency. Like, I can do it. I'm disciplined. I'm hardworking. But I'm tired. I'm tired a lot. Oh, my God.
I will say you have accomplished a lot, in all fairness.
Well, and when I went on this diet, I had this newfound energy and this newfound just motivation, love for life. And I was like, I'm becoming one of those happy, peppy people. And I'm like, how did this happen? I'm not supposed to be one of these people. And, you know, that's supposed to be genetic. They were born that way. They have good genes. And I'm like, what the hell's happening?
Right.
And so, you know, probably it took me like 4 or 5 years because it was highly controversial at that time. And as you know, it's still highly controversial, unfortunately, even though we have really good science now. It's right. still controversial, but it probably took me 4 or 5 years before I started using it with patients. And so that's about 15 years now.
Wow.
And I primarily used it for, you know, I primarily used it for weight loss. And I used it in some patients with treatment-resistant depression who had tried everything that we had to offer, including electric shock therapy, ECT.
Wow.
They'd been hospitalized. They'd been on 30 medications. They had been in psychotherapy, group therapy, everything. And I started using some of them because I was kind of like, well, what do we have to lose? Maybe right. they'll lose a little weight, if nothing else. And lo and behold, I saw some of them starting to get better. I never really made it my career at that point. It was kind of like a little side hobby. It was something that I would do for some of the patients that happened to come my way that I thought would be a good fit for a low-carb or ketogenic diet with
right.
depression. And basically, all of that changed for me, you know, about 3.5 years ago,
okay.
at the beginning of 2016, when one of my very long-term patients that I had been treating for 10 years, diagnosed with schizoaffective disorder, which is kind of a combination of schizophrenia and bipolar disorder,
right.
and he was chronically impaired and chronically ill. He had hallucinations every day. He had delusions all the time. He could
wow.
barely leave home. He was suffering like in
yeah.
unimaginable ways, and could not function in society. And he wanted to help to lose weight. And so I ended up putting him on a ketogenic diet, and he, within 3 months, I'll tell the quick version of that story. Within 3 months, he was really transformed
wow.
into, like, his hallucinations got dramatically better. His delusions got dramatically better. He was losing a lot of weight, but he was able to start functioning in society. He was able to go out in public. He was able to take classes and stick with them and learn the material. Finish like a certification course, for instance.
Wow.
He was able to do things that he had never been able to do, at least not for over 10 years.
My gosh.
Fast forward, he's still my patient. He is not cured. He still takes medication. We're trying to slowly adjust that. But he, you know, is capable of, you know, participating in an improv class and
wow.
performing live in front of people. He couldn't go out in public before. He's
wow.
also lost 150 pounds now.
Oh my gosh.
And
that's huge.
And so his case and one other case, I was at the same time I was treating a woman also with schizoaffective disorder. Combination of the two, schizophrenia and bipolar disorder. She went on a slightly different version of the diet. She was definitely ketogenic, but she wanted to be low fat. So she was low carb and calorie restricted. So she was eating like turkey roll-ups with lettuce and mayonnaise and mustard or something.
Wow.
She was eating low carb vegetables. She wasn't eating a lot.
Okay.
She started losing a weight. She was clearly ketogenic, and she too experienced dramatic reduction of her symptoms.
Wow.
And I ended up publishing both of those cases.
Right.
I published them because I kind of felt like I can't, Like, I can't be quiet about this. This doesn't happen.
No.
People with schizophrenia for decades, they don't get better. Like, I've never seen this in my career. They do not get better. And these people that I've known well, I've put them on lots and lots of different medications, and they never did much. Like, they would help for a month or two, and then they'd get sick again. And, you know, and it was kind of like, this is something dramatic and different. And as a result of that publication, that has, like, essentially in many ways changed my career and changed my career path. So I'm still the head of continuing education at McLean Hospital. I put on Harvard conferences, like all that stuff. But I'm now doing a lot of research on the ketogenic diet and its use in psychiatry. And, you know, I think a lot of your listeners and people who are familiar with the ketogenic diet and metabolic health probably know about the use of the ketogenic diet in epilepsy. So it's been around for 100 years. It is well established scientifically, medically. It is an effective treatment for epilepsy. We know that. And it's not, you know, it's actually not far-fetched and that far of a leap to imagine that medications or treatments for epilepsy can be used in psychiatry. In fact, every medication that is used for epilepsy is used in the field of psychiatry. We use every single thing. So without fail, if something works for epilepsy, it gets used for psychiatric disorders. Well, which psychiatric disorders? Like, which ones? All of them. Like,
wow.
It's all of them. I mean, we use them for bipolar disorder, but we also use them in schizophrenia. We also use them in depression. Lamotrigine is commonly used in depression. We use them in anxiety. We use benzodiazepines. Like, we psychiatrists prescribe more anti-epileptic medications than neurologists do. Why? Because more people have mental disorders than have, you know, epilepsy. Right. Epilepsy is a rare thing.
Right. And
at least compared to mental disorders. And so we're prescribing these medications all the time. So if this is a scientifically proven treatment for epilepsy, it's not far-fetched to think maybe it will work for some psychiatric disorders.
Yeah.
You know, one thing that I want to say is that when I, you know, I want to just kind of get out in front of the naysayers and the skeptics, because there are a lot of them. Yeah. And so a lot of people out there will, you know, as soon as I say diet, they hear ketogenic diet and they hear diet and they think vegetables or losing a little bit of weight.
Right.
Then I say something like schizophrenia, mm-hmm, or bipolar disorder. People immediately have an aversive reaction and a skeptical reaction. And, you know, it's like, that's impossible. There's no way a diet can treat a serious genetic biological disorder like schizophrenia. That is ridiculous.
Yeah.
And most people, I think, you know, I think they have good reason to be skeptical. I'm just going to say that. Because having, you know, been a psychiatrist for 25 years, having worked with hundreds and hundreds of patients with treatment-resistant illness, you know, I've seen patients look on the internet for the latest supplement, the latest, you know, device, the latest come to our spa and we'll cure you of your schizophrenia.
Right.
And there are a lot of kind of quacks out there, or a lot of charlatans out there.
Yeah.
People who are not credible, people who are selling snake oil, people who are preying on desperate, vulnerable people who will do anything to get better, who will do anything to save themselves, and our conventional treatments aren't doing so hot, so why not try something alternative and different?
Right.
And so I know that those things happen. I know that those people are out there. And unfortunately, I know that for the majority of people, when I say the ketogenic diet for schizophrenia they think I'm one of them. They think those quacks, they think I'm one of those charlatans. Well, let me just, I would love the opportunity to kind of address this just a little bit.
Yeah.
So first of all, I have no financial interests whatsoever with the ketogenic diet, if anything that I'm doing. The only thing that I get paid for at all is to sometimes come and speak at a conference. So I'm educating people, I'm speaking, I have to take time off from work, go to a conference. And so sometimes I get paid to do that. That's it. I don't even have a book out yet. I'm working on one, but it's not...
I was
going to
ask.
I don't even have a book to sell you right now. I have no supplements. Wow. I have nothing. I am not trying to get rich off of this. My passion for this comes from working with people for 25 years, having them in tears in my office, begging me for help, begging me to make their life better, to make their suffering stop. And I do everything in my power to help them, and it doesn't work. And so when I have come across something that there's good scientific reason to believe, this actually makes sense, it might work, I'm going to become a passionate advocate for this treatment. My passion, my advocacy is not about myself. It's not even about keto, really. It's about helping people who are suffering, helping people who are trapped, helping people who will do anything, including a diet, who will do anything to improve their health and decrease their suffering. And I will never back down in my advocacy for them. And so I'm like happy to take on any naysayers, any skeptics, any people who think this is quackery. I will take them on in a second. The really interesting thing, so the big picture, and this is, I didn't even know this when it happened. Like, I hadn't done this research. I've been a researcher for 20 years. I've done a lot of research in addiction research. I've worked in an addiction research lab here at the hospital. I am an educator. I run continuing education. I also educate Harvard residents and medical students. So I do all sorts of things. I lost my train of thought.
No, you're just, I mean, I have to say, I have so much respect for you and what you just said. I mean, it takes such a level of just courage, I think, especially as a psychiatrist where, you know, there's a variety of places that this diet is being sort of implemented, you know, in epilepsy for the last 100 years, but mental health, the research around that with the ketogenic diet is so scarce. And the fact that you are not only like using it in your practice and made that choice to start doing that for patients who otherwise might not have any other options, it just says so much about who you are. And I was excited to have you as a speaker at Metabolic Health Summit before. I have to say I'm so much more, I just feel the passion literally coming through Instagram right now. Oh. And I have so much respect for you in that sense, because there are so many people around the world right now that are suffering with a variety of mental health issues that maybe feel like maybe they don't have any options, that don't know that nutrition might be something that they could just do in their own kitchen that might make a difference, in their life. That could be huge, right?
Yeah, no, and I remembered where I was going with that. So I've done all of this stuff, and what I was going to say is the last 4 years have put me on a path to understand a lot of basic research. So this is like really nerdy cellular biochemical research on what causes mental disorders. I was never really interested in that before. I did clinical research. I was more interested in like what will help them. Right. Practically speaking, so that's really always been my primary focus, is I want to know concretely what can I do to help this person in front of me. But the last 4 years have put on kind of a nerdy path of diving into cell biology and other things. And so it turns out that we have known about the connection between mental disorders and metabolic disorders for well over a century. So we have known, so psychiatrists in the 1800s noticed that people with mental disorders were more likely to get diabetes. And they also noticed that diabetes sometimes runs in families. And when it does run in families, those families have high rates of mental disorders. They, like the mother might be diabetic, the sister might be diabetic, and the brother has schizophrenia.
Wow.
They have noticed, so that connection has been noticed for over a century, and over the last 40, 50 years now, we have abundant epidemiologic data from huge studies, millions of people, confirming this connection between mental disorders and metabolic disorders. So people who have diabetes are more likely to have pretty much all of the mental disorders. But the interesting thing is these are all bidirectional relationships. And so if you look at people who have mental disorders, people with schizophrenia are three times more likely to develop diabetes than the general population. And it's not, everybody says it's the medications we put them on.
I was going to ask.
And there's no question, the medications we put them on actually cause diabetes. So this has been a huge conundrum. Like, well, are we causing it with our medications? Turns out we are. The medications are, in fact, making a bad situation worse in terms of metabolism. But when people come to the hospital with their first episode of psychosis, before they even get one dose of medication, they already show signs of developing diabetes.
Insulin resistance is already there.
Insulin resistance, in particular, insulin resistance in the brain. And so we know there's a connection between diabetes and mental disorders, all of them. We also know there's a connection between cardiovascular disease and mental disorders. So people with schizophrenia and bipolar disorder, they lose like 25 years of their life on average.
They lose
one third of their lifespan. And they're dying of heart attacks, mostly heart attacks and cancer.
Right.
They get a lot of the complications of diabetes because a lot of them have diabetes too. But people with depression, so depression alone ends up being a major risk factor for having a heart attack. And then once you have a heart attack, like among people who've had a heart attack, one fourth of them are clinically depressed, and one third of people in excessive heart failure are clinically depressed. And everybody writes that off. They write it off because they say, well, it sucks to be them. Wouldn't you be depressed if you had a heart attack? But here's the thing. So if I take two people with heart attacks, both of them are in the hospital, they both weigh the same amount, they were both smokers, they both have pretty much all the same risk factors. If one of them has depression and one of them doesn't have depression, the one with depression is twice as likely to have another heart attack in the next year as the one without depression. That is a physical problem. That is not a mental problem. Yes, it's mental too. Yes, it causes suffering. Yes, it causes depression. But I look at the connection between mental and metabolic is that a metabolic problem means that your body has trouble producing energy in its cells. The brain is the most sensitive organ to energy problems because our brains are like a supercomputer.
Yep.
And they need like exquisitely fine-tuned energy. And so when there is a metabolic problem in the body, the brain may just not be working right. And that, in fact, may define a lot of what we call these mental disorders. And the evidence shows it. the really fascinating thing is that when we look at people, you know, I've consulted with a lot of researchers, basic science researchers who are doing cell biology research. And when you look at people with mental disorders, in particular, chronic depression, bipolar disorder, and schizophrenia. So those are the kind of like the big three in psychiatry. And when you look at people with those disorders, their cells show metabolic distress. So their cells have higher levels of inflammation, higher levels of reactive oxygen species. Their cells show lower levels of ATP, which is like energy. And they show high levels of lactate. We've known this since the 1960s. This is not new science. There are tens of thousands of scientific articles on this. That is not cutting edge at all. That is old news. The problem is nobody knew what to do with it. Nobody, we've tried antioxidants. Everybody thought vitamin E was going to save the day, save us all. Unfortunately, vitamin E doesn't save us. It doesn't do much.
Doesn't solve all our problems.
we have to change our metabolism. And so the ketogenic diet is a metabolic intervention. So the one more thing I want to say about this is that, you know, a lot of times when I'm talking about ketogenic diet for schizophrenia or for treatment-resistant depression or whatever, a lot of people are like, oh, yeah, so bad diet causes those, right? And I want to be clear. No, that is not what I'm saying. There are people saying that, and I'm not sure I agree with that.
Yeah.
We do know that eating a lot of highly processed foods, we know that eating a lot of sugar does make it more likely that you might develop depression. So we know that from pretty good studies for depression. And we know it for depression because depression is a more common disorder. To be able to prove something like that for something like schizophrenia is more difficult because schizophrenia doesn't affect that many people. So you need like tens of millions people, and you need to follow them, and you need to be able to reliably say how much sugar were they eating. So that's a question to answer. We do know it for depression, but I want to like put the common sense check on. Schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, depression, anxiety have existed for thousands of years. They existed before the standard American diet existed. So we cannot single-handedly blame the standard American diet for mental disorders.
Right.
Because if it was really just a bad diet, that wouldn't make sense. So then why am I talking about a diet for mental disorders? The ketogenic diet, I kind of wish it wasn't called a diet, at least the form that I use.
I agree.
The form that I use should be called a metabolic intervention or a ketogenic treatment or a ketogenic therapy or something. Mm-hmm. Because it is changing the way our body makes energy. And it's changing the way our brains make energy. And even if a diet wasn't the cause of your mental disorder, a ketogenic intervention might be an effective treatment for it.
Yeah.
And so one of the last things I'm going to say one last thing.
No, I could talk to you all day, I think, about this.
And then I'll talk.
No, I love it.
So one last thing I want to say to kind of defend my like quackery, you know, accusation. So for people who think I'm just a quack, you know, that Chris Palmer, he's at Harvard. How'd they let him? They better get rid of him soon. I want to say over the last 4 years, I have now consulted with, collaborated with, or spoken with 17 different research groups from around the world who are pursuing research and clinical work on the ketogenic diet and mental disorders. So right now, research studies are already approved or underway at very reputable institutions, such as Harvard Medical School, where I'm at, but also Johns Hopkins, Stanford University, Columbia, Oxford, the National Institute on Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism and the National Institute of Drug Abuse. And we as a group of researchers are studying disorders as diverse as schizophrenia, depression, bipolar disorder, autism, Alzheimer's disease, anorexia nervosa, opioid addiction, and alcohol addiction. And
wow.
I want to say for the record, don't go out and do this on your own. Don't go out and try to treat.
Thank you for saying that.
Don't go out and try to treat your own schizophrenia. Don't go out and try to treat your, like, these are serious disorders. And so, like, is this a do-it-yourself kind of thing at home? I wish it was, and some aspects of it will be. But no, like, these are really serious disorders. If you have diabetes, please don't just, like, wing it and, like, right. You know, and go cold turkey off.
Especially if you're on insulin.
Like, you've gotta like be monitored, and you've gotta be safe and reasonable, and you need to slowly wean yourself off of medications, and you need to make sure everything's good, safe, and And so there's a process. We as the medical community need to be supporting people who want to try these interventions, and we as the medical community need to learn how to apply these interventions and motivate and encourage people to do them and keep them safe. But those are just some of the things that I'm going to be talking about at the Metabolic Summit in 2020. And so I hope everyone who's listening is going to come and meet me and all of the other awesome speakers.
Yeah, no, we're so thrilled to have you out there. And we're going to be really taking a deep dive into mental health. It's such an important topic. There are so many people. We talked about some of the numbers just with clinical depression. I mean, 322 million, I think it is, approximately right now, which is just insane. This is an epidemic. This is something that needs immediate attention and maybe some alternatives to work synergistically with current standard of care. And if it's something as simple as people making the choices in their own kitchen, why not? Obviously, alongside supervision with their physician. So if you want to start a diet, you are dealing with something, some sort of mental health issue, make sure you consult with your physician. I want to ask those that are watching, if you have some questions, feel free to type them in the little comment box for Dr. Palmer here, because we've got him on for maybe a few more minutes. And if you have questions, definitely ask them. He can't give out personal medical advice. I want to say that. But I want to ask, though, because, you know, you're a rare gem in the world of psychiatrists when it comes to, you know, finding a physician who's open to, obviously, you know, prescription medication and the current standards that you have in mental health are important. But to find somebody who's also open, you know, we say, you know, don't start a diet without working with your doctor first. But it's sometimes very challenging, I think, to find somebody who might be open to that, because it's still very, very, very new. I mean, you were shooting in the dark completely when you started. I mean, you were unmarked territory. That's why I think you're such a pioneer in this. And so what would you tell that person that's looking for that support? I'm sure you guys are maybe trying to collate like a list of or hopefully other mental health providers.
We are. Awesome. We are. So you know, that it's such an important question. And so I'm being contacted sometimes on a daily basis by people all over the world, you know, asking for help, begging for help, and I've been turning people away. So lest you think I'm just trying to fill my private practice or my, you know, clinic or whatever, and that's how I'm making money off this, I'm turning everyone away right now, I'm sorry to say, because I don't have time to treat more people and do the research and do everything else I'm trying to work on. And so I do have a website, chrispalmermd.com. And I have two people, Cecile and Christy and Anne, three people really, who are helping with this project, who are helping because I can't do everything. And like, they came to me, like, it's amazing that really awesome, smart, motivated people come to you and say, we want to help you and we'll even do it for free. I'm like, how the hell does that happen?
That's like, amazing. I mean, it shows how powerful and how much potential what you're trying to do can have on the world. I mean, people know that, right? I think that says a lot.
It is amazing. So they have wonderfully helped collate a list of resources. So we have a lot of the resources for the ketogenic diet for epilepsy, and that's kind of the model that I'm using right now because of the obvious thing. If it works for epilepsy, maybe it'll work for a serious psychiatric disorder. If you're somebody with mild depression and you want to lose weight, I'd say do the keto diet and try to lose some weight. Do you need medical supervision? Probably not. You can go do the diet and lose the weight. And for you, it really is a diet. For people trying to treat a really serious medical disorder or mental health disorder, I do think they need two things. I think they need a competent mental health professional who is on board. And it doesn't mean they need to do everything, but that mental health professional needs to take some ownership of helping to monitor your symptoms, to help keep you safe. If you should get suicidal, if you should get more depressed, if you should get more psychotic, they're going to be there to help you with that. And that is a whole skill set that comes with training to be a mental health professional, whether it's a psychiatrist, a nurse practitioner, a psychologist, a social worker. Like, you need a trained mental health professional who's going to be there for that aspect of it and monitoring the treatment. One thing I want to say about this treatment is powerful and it's like a medication. And if you do this diet and you get dramatically better, and then you decide, well, I'm all better now, I can stop the diet and I can go eat, you know, pizza. Yeah. Be prepared to have a major flare-up of your symptoms. And sometimes those flare-ups are extraordinarily dangerous. And I just want to put that out there. Sometimes those symptom flare-ups are suicide attempts or suicidality. Sometimes they're psychosis with kind of dangerous behaviors, aggressive behaviors. They include all sorts of things that need to be monitored. And so that mental health professional needs to be there for you if you cheat on the diet, even if the diet's working for you. I think after several years, some people can go into complete remission and can live happily ever after without any medic. And I've got some stories about that. And we've got case reports that are even published in the medical literature, not just on Psychology Today, but in the medical literature. And I'll talk about that at the conference. But so if you go to my website, we've collated a list of all of these resources on how to do the ketogenic diet for epilepsy, and we've got clinicians. So I lost my train of thought. Two things you need: mental health professional is one, and the second thing you need is somebody who knows how to do the keto diet.
Yeah.
And so that could be your mental health professional if he or she wants to learn how to do this and really take it on and know how to monitor labs, know how to deal with side effects, know how to, you know, deal with keto adaptation, know how to make suggestions for what you should eat if you're getting bored, if you hate your meals, if you, you know, whatever. If your clinician wants to be that person and is competent to be that person, then yeah, I'm all for it. So with a lot of the patients that I treat, I am that person. But
wow,
there are a lot of ketogenic, you know, dietitians who, they know this better than I do. They know this better than everyone else on the planet, because this is what they do day in and day out. And they will come up with meal plans. They will be able to recommend to the physician lab values that should be measured and monitored. And, you know, it could be a primary care doc who wants to do the keto part, but I think you need a team. Unfortunately, there aren't a lot of teams out there, especially who are willing to, even among the keto community, even among some of the bastions and the leaders of the keto community, they don't want to deal with schizophrenia. They don't want bipolar disorder. They don't, They don't want that in their practice. And I don't blame them. It's not that they're being mean. They're not trained in how to treat these disorders. And I want to say they're being smart. They're being wise. They're recognizing these are serious disorders. It's more than ego. And I'm not equipped. I'm not trained in how to assess psychosis and whether it's getting better or not and what to do about it. If the person cheats and gets floridly psychotic, like, what do I do about that?
Right.
And but they could partner with mental health professionals who do want to be part of a keto team. And so the mental health professionals can do what they do and they can be assessed, like, is this diet helping or not helping? And then some of the keto, you know, primary care docs or the keto clinics could be helping with this. Right now, I don't think they're doing it. And everybody's afraid of suicide. Everybody's afraid of psychosis. I don't blame them. I think that's well-founded. So the sad news, unfortunately, for a lot of people who really want to do this treatment is it's hard to do. What I've recommended to people in general is go to my website, print out some of the articles. If you're talking with a doctor, especially print out the ones that I've published in medical journals. You may not understand it, but your doctor will. It will build credibility. Your doctor will, oh, this is published in a really good journal. Like, oh, maybe there's something to it. Maybe I should consider it.
Yeah.
And if you can convince your mental health professional to be your mental health professional and let you try this, and they're on board with you trying it, finding a keto dietitian is much easier. And so I do have some resources. I have at least 3 or 4 keto dietitians who have told me in person that they are willing and happy to work with patients with serious psychiatric diagnoses, and they will do the keto part of it as long as there's a mental health clinician as part of the team. And that, I think, is working for some people. I'm hearing from people all over the world sharing their success stories. A lot of them, unfortunately, had to wing it and do it on their own. And thank God they got through that safely and it worked out for them. But I'm hearing from others who are like, oh, I saw your article 2 years ago and I'm now in remission because of you. And I'm like, wow. Like, when I published my article, I thought everyone would laugh at it. And I thought I was going to be seen as like this quack charlatan guy. And
no.
Nobody's going to listen. So
that's incredible. I mean, that really, I can almost guarantee there's people all over the world that are looking to you and your resources and your website and trying to find those resources. And like you said, it really takes, I think, a team sort of collaborative effort right now, just because a lot of the resources out there are so scarce, but there are some really great people in the field that are so passionate about this, such as yourselves, that are very much willing to help as much as they can. Obviously, you've got a lot on your plate. We've got some great dietitians that are going to be coming out to Metabolic Health Summit as well that do deal with this kind of thing. Beth Zupak-Kania, and as well as Denise Potter, Marion Kalamian came out last year. So we've got, there's so many great people in this space. And the crazy part is that this diet extends to a variety of different things. I mean, mental health is probably, in my opinion, one of the top most important things, you know, that we're facing right now. But there's, I mean, it's got an application and has for many years, obviously, in epilepsy, but cancer. And when you start listing off all these things, it does sound a little bit like snake oil, but the science is there. And it's people like you that are truly making a difference and paving the way so that we can hopefully get to a place where nutrition, especially low-carb nutrition, is a part of the thought process as people maybe upon diagnosis is part of the plan. You know, I think that what we eat every single day can have a powerful impact. So, but I do want to remind people, if you're thinking of starting the diet, definitely talk to your doctor and maybe get them on board. I mean, you know, if you could imagine all of the people on this live right now, say everybody's kind of maybe dealing with something or knows somebody or has a loved one that's facing a mental illness, which it's highly likely with the statistics that that's the case. Say every one of those people then took, you know, an article from your website or, you know, one of your publications and brought that in to another doctor, another psychiatrist. Think about the ripple effect that might have. So That's just 2 cents I want to throw out there, but we do have one question that is quite a deep question. So I don't know if we can fully answer it today, but it's about, and I think it's still being researched as well, just in terms of what do you think the mechanism of action is when it comes to the application of the keto diet for severe mental disorders, such as the ones that you mentioned. Obviously, there's a lot of similarities between what you mentioned and things like epilepsy, and those mechanisms I think are being researched. But what are your thoughts on that specifically?
So it's definitely going to be part of my talk.
People have to come to watch it.
I've kind of become a cell biology nerd. I never wanted to be, but I'm like, okay, this has become like a life's calling thing. It's putting it together. Because I know, like, just saying diet, you know, everybody wants to know exactly this question. What are the mechanisms of action? So the reality is that we know of at least probably 40 or so different mechanisms of action of the ketogenic diet. Is there one in particular that results, you know, in an anti-seizure effect? Is there one in particular that might help somebody who's having psychotic symptoms? We definitely cannot say right now, but what I can definitely say is that a lot of those 40 mechanisms of action are all interrelated. That when you change insulin resistance, for instance, so one of the mechanisms of action of the keto diet is it improves insulin resistance. Why? Because you're lowering insulin levels and you're lowering glucose levels. And over time, that allows the insulin receptors to become sensitized again, and they work better. And we know that people with serious mental disorders have insulin resistance in their brains. They have it in their brains even when it's not in their arm. So when you draw blood, even continuous glucose monitoring, unfortunately, that does not always pick up insulin resistance in the brain.
Right.
And I'll talk a lot more about insulin in the brain because there's a lot to say about that. But that's just one example. But when you improve insulin resistance, that has a whole cascade of effects on levels of inflammation and reactive oxygen species, autophagy and cellular repair.
Right.
And so what we know about this diet, you know, again, I mentioned earlier that we know this is fact. We know that the cells of people with serious mental disorders have metabolic problems. That is not controversial. That is not even cutting edge. That is fact. And we've got tens of thousands of studies documenting this dating back to the 1960s. So this is a metabolic intervention. What do I mean by metabolic intervention? The ketogenic diet improves most of those metabolic markers. So the ketogenic diet, you know, in a cell that has lower levels of ATP, the ketogenic diet will increase those levels of ATP. In a cell that has levels of inflammation, high levels of inflammation, the ketogenic diet will lower those levels of inflammation. What the trendy thing to say, which is absolutely true, most people think about mental disorders as being related to neurotransmitters. It's a chemical imbalance. And the chemical are the neurotransmitters. Those are the chemicals that go between brain cells and spread messages. We know that the ketogenic diet changes levels of neurotransmitters in the brain. It changes them in very specific ways that we know should, in theory, help improve symptoms of serious mental disorders. So for example, we know that people with schizophrenia, they have decreased activity of GABA, which is an inhibitory neurotransmitter. It kind of calms things down. And, or they actually have, they have decreased activity of it, and the ketogenic diet increases the activity of GABA. So so that's an inhibitory neurotransmitter. that tends to be calming. It also tends to be anti-seizure. And that's one of the, you know, obvious ways that it might stop seizures. It's also one of the obvious ways it might help someone with anxiety, because most of the anxiety medications we prescribe people, which do work, I'm not saying I'm anti-medication at all. They do work. Why do they work? Because they increase your GABA levels. Well, this diet also does the same thing.
Ah, there you are. I'm not sure what happened.
I'm not either.
But
it just went off. Yeah. I was too long-winded.
No, it was great.
The Instagram police said that I've spoken enough.
That's it. No, but I, you know, we were kind of diving into some of the mechanisms, and I think it's so fascinating, just obviously all of the ways in which the ketogenic diet works and all the sort of ripple effects that it can sort of have, right? And you were going into some of those details, which I know you're going to cover, and I know you're so busy, by the way, as well, because I so appreciate you taking the time out. And I think I could literally talk to you all day about this topic because it's so important and it affects so many of us, right? And it's something that is so exciting because it's so necessary. The work you're doing is so necessary to move this field forward. So thank you for taking such a deep dive into everything today. And I just wanted to pop back in and let people know they can find you obviously on your website that you mentioned, chrispalmermd.com.
Yeah.
Anything else you want to mention before we head out? Obviously, people can watch you live at Metabolic Health Summit, where you'll really, I mean, you'll get to connect with Dr. Palmer and watch him speak really in depth about some of these topics that he's discussed today. So,
yeah, no, and I am so looking forward to the Metabolic Health Summit as a participant, because I'm looking forward to hearing from all of the other speakers and learning from them. So I highly encourage people to come to the conference. I will be more than happy to share a lot more information on this topic. I can definitely answer a lot of questions. I can answer detailed questions. I can't be your doctor.
Right.
I can't give medical advice, but I can answer questions like mechanisms of action.
Yeah.
You'll get a few more of those, but I won't have time to do all of them, but I've got some summary slides with a lot of them. And I know some of your other speakers, like Eric Kosoff and John Rowe, will be going over mechanism of action of the ketogenic diet as well. And so there's going to be a lot of overlap, and I'm going to probably defer to them on some of those topics. And so I can do more of the mental health stuff. But right. So chrispalmermd.com, come there. I think that's the biggest thing, is I really am being contacted so often. And so we're, you know, the three women that are helping me and I are trying to put up as much information as we can on the website, kind of knowing our conundrum that we can't treat the world. We can't, like, so we need to make it successful. We need to recruit some clinicians. Like, clinicians, come forward. So if any of you are clinicians, and you are willing to work, if you're a licensed clinician and you are willing to help work with people, either as a mental health clinician or as a keto clinician, whatever, please be in touch with us through the website and we will add you to the list, because I'm telling you now, there are desperate people all over the world who are begging for help. They even have money and they want to pay you. They're willing to pay you, and I'm turning them all away saying, I can't treat the world. I'm sorry.
Right. But so, you're putting the great resources out there. You've got articles, publications. I mean, and this is just the start for you. I feel like there's so much more ahead, and you're going to be talking a lot about the work that you've done and where you're headed at Metabolic Health Summit. And we're so thankful for the work that you do. We're so thankful to have you at the conference. And for those who are watching, it's January 30th through February 2nd. You can find tickets, metabolichealthsummit.com, and watch Dr. Palmer speak live. And we can't wait. So thank you for taking all the time today. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, no, thank you so much. And I look forward to seeing all of you at the conference.
Sounds great. All right. Bye. We'll see you soon.
Bye.